This is a LibriVox recording. All LibriVox recordings are in the public domain. For more information, or to volunteer, please visit LibriVox.org. This reading by Christine Blashford, www.wokeupthismorning.co.uk. The Price of Love by Arnold Bennett. Chapter 2. Louis's Discovery. Part 1. Louis Fores was late at his grand-aunt's because he had, by a certain preoccupation, during a period of about an hour, been rendered oblivious of the passage of time. The real origin of the affair went back nearly 60 years to an indecorous episode in the history of the Malden family. At that date, before Mrs. Malden had even met Austin Malden, her future husband, Austin's elder brother Athelstan, who was well established as an earthenware broker in London, had a conjugal misfortune which reached its climax in the matrimonial court and left the injured and stately Athelstan with an incomplete household, a spoiled home, and the sole care of two children, a boy and a girl. These children were, almost of necessity, clumsily brought up. The girl married the half-brother of a Lieutenant General Fores, and Louis Fores was their son. The boy married an American girl and had issue Julian Malden and some daughters. At the age of 18, Louis Fores, amiable, personable, and an orphan, was looking for a career. He had lived in the London suburb of Barnes, and under the influence of a father, whose career had chiefly been to be the stepbrother of Lieutenant General Fores. He was in full possession of the conventionally snobbish ideals of the suburb, reinforced by more than a tincture of the stupendous and unsurpassed snobbishness of the British army. He had no money, and therefore the liberal professions and the higher division of the civil service were closed to him. He had the choice of two activities. He might tout for wine, motor cars, or mineral waters on commission, like his father, or he might enter a bank. His friends were agreed that nothing else was conceivable. He chose the living grave. It is not easy to enter the living grave, but August influences aiding, he entered it with éclat at a salary of £70 a year, and it closed over him. He would have been secure till his second death had he not defiled the bier. The day of judgment occurred, the grave opened, and he was thrown out with ignominy, but ignominy unpublished. The August influences, by simple cash and for their own sakes, had saved him from exposure and a jury. In order to get rid of him, his protectors spoke well of him, emphasizing his many good qualities, and he was deported to the Five Towns, properly enough since his grandfather had come thence, and there joined the staff of Batchgrew and Sons, thanks to the kind intervention of Mrs. Malden. At the end of a year, John Batchgrew told him to go, and told Mrs. Malden that her grandnephew had a fault. Mrs. Malden was very sorry. At this juncture, Louis Fores, without intending to do so, would certainly have turned Mrs. Malden's last years into a tragedy, had he not in the very nick of time inherited about £1,000. He was rehabilitated. He had money now. He had a fortune. He had £10,000. He had any sum you like, according to the caprice of rumour. He lived on his means for a little time, frequenting the Municipal School of Art at the Wedgwood Institute at Bursley, and then old Batchgrew had casually suggested to Mrs. Malden that there ought to be an opening for him with Jim Horrocleave, who was understood to be succeeding with his patent special processes for earthenware manufacture. Mr. Horrocleave, a man with a chin, would not accept him for a partner, having no desire to share profits with anybody, but on the faith of his artistic tendency, and Mrs. Malden's correct yet highly misleading catalogue of his virtues, he took him at a salary, in return for which Louis was to be the confidential employee who could and would do anything, including design. And now Louis was the step-nephew of a lieutenant-general, a man of private means and of talent, and a trusted employee with a fine wage, all under one skin. He shone in Bursley, and no wonder. He was very active at Horrocleave's. He not only designed shapes for vases, and talked intimately with Jim Horrocleave about fresh projects, but he controlled the petty cash. The expenditure of petty cash grew, as was natural in a growing business. Mr. Horrocleave soon got accustomed to that, and apparently gave it no thought, signing cheques instantly upon request. But on the very day of Mrs. Malden's party, after signing a cheque and before handing it to Louis, he had somewhat lengthily consulted his private cash-book, and as he handed over the cheque, had said, "Let's have a squint at the petty cash-book tomorrow morning, Louis." He said it gruffly, but he was a gruff man. He left early. He might have meant anything or nothing. Louis could not decide which, or rather, from 5 o'clock to 7 he had come to alternating decisions every 5 minutes. Part 2. It was just about at the time when Louis ought to have been removing his paper cuff shields in order to start for Mrs. Maldon's that he discovered the full extent of his debt to the petty cash-box. He sat alone at a rough and dirty desk in the inner room of the works office, surrounded by dust-covered sample vases and other vessels of all shapes, sizes, and tints, specimens of Horrocleave's art lustre ware, a melancholy array of ingenious ugliness that nevertheless filled with pride its creators. He looked through a dirt-obscured window, and with unseeing gaze surveyed a muddy, littered quadrangle, whose twilight was reddened by gleams from the engine-house. In this yard lay flat a sign that had been blown down from the façade of the manufactory 6 months before. Horrocleave. Art. Lustre. Ware. Within the room was another sign, itself fashioned in lustre-ware. Horrocleave. Art. Lustre. Ware. And the envelopes and paper and bill-heads on the desk all bore the same legend. Horrocleave. Art. Lustre. Ware. He owed £73 to the petty cash-box, and he was startled and shocked. He was startled because for weeks past he had refrained from adding up the columns of the cash-book, partly from idleness and partly from a desire to remain in ignorance of his own doings. He had hoped for the best. He had faintly hoped that the deficit would not exceed £10, or 12. He had been prepared for a deficit of 25, or even 30. But 73 really shocked. Nay, it staggered. It meant that in addition to his salary, some 30 shillings a week had been mysteriously trickling through the incurable hole in his pocket, not to mention other debts. He well knew that to Shillitoe alone, his admirable tailor, he owed £18. It may be asked how a young bachelor, with private means and a fine salary, living in a district where prices are low and social conventions not costly, could have come to such a pass. The answer is that Louis had no private means, and that his salary was not fine. The £1,000 had gradually vanished, as £1,000 will, in the refinements of material existence and in the pursuit of happiness. His bank account had long been in abeyance. His salary was £3 a week. Many a member of the liberal professions, many a solicitor, for example, brings up a family on £3 a week in the provinces. But for a lieutenant-general's nephew, who had once had £1,000 in one lump, £3 a week was inadequate. As a fact, Louis conceived himself art director of Horrocleave's, and sincerely thought that as such he was ill-paid. Herein was one of his private excuses for eccentricity with the petty cash. It might also be asked what Louis had to show for his superb expenditure. The answer is, nothing. With the £73 desolatingly clear in his mind, he quitted his desk in order to reconnoitre the outer and larger portion of the counting-house. He went as far as the archway, and saw black smoke being blown downwards from heaven into Friendly Street. A policeman was placidly regarding the smoke as he strolled by, and Louis, though absolutely sure that the officer would not carry out his plain duty of summoning Horrocleave for committing a smoke nuisance, did not care for the spectacle of the policeman. He returned to the inner office and locked the door. The staff and the hands had all gone, save one or two piece-workers in the painting-shop across the yard. The night watchman, fresh from bed, was moving fussily about the yard. He nodded with respect to Louis through the grimy window. Louis lit the gas and spread a newspaper in front of the window by way of blind. And then he began a series of acts on the petty cash-book. The office clock indicated 6:20. He knew that time was short, but he had a natural gift for the invention and execution of these acts, and he calculated that under 30 minutes would suffice for them. But when he next looked at the clock, the acts being accomplished, 1 hour had elapsed. It had seemed to him more like 1/4 hour. Yet, as blotting paper cannot safely be employed in such delicate calligraphic feats as those of Louis's, even 1 hour was not excessive for what he had done. An operator clumsier, less cool, less cursory, more cautious than himself, might well have spent 30 minutes over the job. He locked up the book, washed his hands and face with remarkable celerity in a filthy lavatory basin, brushed his hair, removed his cuff shields, changed his coat, and fled at speed, leaving the key of the office with the watchman. Part 3. "I suppose the old lady was getting anxious," said he brightly, but in a low tone so that the old lady should not hear, as he shook hands with Rachel in the lobby. He had recognised her in front of him up the lane, had, in fact, nearly overtaken her, and she was standing at the open door when he mounted the steps. She had had just time to prove to Mrs. Maldon by a "He's coming!" thrown through the sitting-room doorway that she had not waited for Louis Fores, and walked up with him. "Yes," Rachel replied in the same tone, most deceitfully leaving him under the false impression that it was the old lady's anxiety that had sent her out. She had then emerged scatheless in reputation from the indiscreet adventure. The house was animated by the arrival of Louis. At once it seemed to live more keenly when he had crossed the threshold. And Louis found pleasure in the house, in the welcoming aspect of its interior, in Rachel's evident excited gladness at seeing him, in her honest and agreeable features, and in her sheer girlishness. A few minutes earlier he had been in the sordid and dreadful office. Now he was in another and a cleaner, prettier world. He yielded instantly and fully to its invitation, for he had the singular faculty of being able to cast off care like a garment. He felt sympathetic towards women, and eager to employ for their contentment all the charm which he knew he possessed. He gave himself generously in every gesture and intonation. "Office, auntie, office!" he exclaimed, elegantly entering the parlour. "Sackcloth, ashes, hello! Where's Julian? Is he late, too?" When he had received the news about Julian Maldon, he asked to see the telegram, and searched out its place of origin, and drew forth a pocket timetable, and remarked in a wise way that he hoped Julian would make the connection at Derby. Lastly, he predicted the precise minute at which Julian ought to be knocking at the front door, and both women felt their ignorant, puzzled inferiority in these recondite matters of travel, and the comfort of having an omniscient male in the house. Then, slightly drawing up his dark blue trousers with an accustomed movement, he carefully sat down on the Chesterfield, and stroked his soft black moustache, which was estimably long for a fellow of 23, and patted his black hair. "Rachel, you didn't fasten that landing window after all," said Mrs. Maldon, looking over Louis's head at the lady companion, who hesitated modestly near the door. "I've tried, but I couldn't." "Neither could I, Mrs. Maldon," said Rachel. "I was thinking perhaps Mr. Fores wouldn't mind." She did not explain that her failure to fasten the window had been more or less deliberate, since while actually tugging at the window she had been visited by the sudden delicious thought, "How nice it would be to ask Louis Fores to do this hard thing for me!" And now she had asked him. "Certainly!" Louis jumped to his feet, and off he went upstairs. Most probably, if the sudden delicious thought had not skipped into Rachel's brain, he would never have made that critical ascent to the first floor. A gas jet burned low on the landing. "Let's have a little light on the subject," he cheerfully muttered to himself, as he turned on the gas to the full. Then, in the noisy blaze of yellow and blue light, he went to the window, and with a single fierce wrench he succeeded in pulling the catch into position. He was proud of his strength. It pleased him to think of the weakness of women. It pleased him to anticipate the impressed thanks of the weak women for this exertion of his power on their behalf. "Have you managed it so soon?" his aunt would exclaim, and he would answer in a carefully off-hand way, "Of course, why not?" He was about to descend, but he remembered that he must not leave the gas at full. With his hand on the tap, he glanced perfunctorily around the little landing. The door of Mrs. Maldon's bedroom was in front of him, at right angles to the window. By the door, which was ajar, stood a cane-seated chair. Underneath the chair he perceived a whitish package or roll that seemed to be out of place there on the floor. He stooped and picked it up, and as the paper rustled peculiarly in his hand, he could feel his heart give a swift bound. He opened the roll. It consisted of nothing whatever but banknotes. He listened intently with ear cocked and rigid limbs, and he could just catch the soothing murmur of women's voices in the parlour beneath the reverberating solemn pulse of the lobby clock. Part 4. Louis Fores had been intoxicated into a condition of poesy. He was deliciously incapable of any precise thinking. He could not formulate any theory to account for the startling phenomenon of a roll of banknotes loose under a chair on a first-floor landing of his great-aunt's house. He could not even estimate the value of the roll. He felt only that it was indefinitely prodigious. But he had the most sensitive appreciation of the exquisite beauty of those pieces of papers. They were not merely beautiful because they stood for delight and indulgence, raising lovely visions of hosiers and jewellers' shops and the night interiors of clubs and restaurants, raising one clear vision of himself clasping a watch bracelet on the soft arm of Rachel, who had so excitingly smiled upon him a moment ago. They were beautiful in themselves. The aspect and very texture of them were beautiful, surpassing pictures and fine scenery. They were the most poetic things in the world. They transfigured the narrow gas-lit first-floor landing of his great-aunt's house into a secret and unearthly grove of bliss. He was drunk with quivering emotion. And then, as he gazed at the divine characters printed in sable on the rustling whiteness, he was aware of a stab of ugly, coarse pain. Up to the instant of beholding those banknotes he had been convinced that his operations upon the petty cash-book would be entirely successful, and that the immediate future of Horrocleave was assured of tranquillity. He had been blandly certain that Horrocleave held no horrid suspicion against him, and that even if Horrocleave's pate did conceal a dark thought, it would be conjured at once away by the superficial reasonableness of the falsified accounts. But now his mind was terribly and inexplicably changed, and it seemed to him impossible to gull the acute and mighty Horrocleave. Failure, exposure, disgrace, ruin seemed inevitable, and also intolerable. It was astonishing that he should have deceived himself into an absurd security. The banknotes, by some magic virtue which they possessed, had opened his eyes to the truth, and they presented themselves as absolutely indispensable to him. They had sprung from naught, they belonged to nobody, they existed without a creative cause in the material world, and they were indispensable to him. Could it be conceived that he should lose his high and brilliant position in the town, that two policemen should hustle him into the black van, that the gates of a prison should clang behind him? It could not be conceived. It was monstrously inconceivable. The banknotes, he saw them wavy as through a layer of hot air. A heavy knock on the front door below shook him and the floor and the walls. He heard the hurried feet of Rachel, the opening of the door, and Julian's harsh, hoarse voice. Julian, then, was not quite an hour late, after all. The stir in the lobby seemed to be enormous, and very close to him. Mrs. Maldon had come forth from the parlour to greet Julian on his birthday. Louis stuck the banknotes into the side pocket of his coat, and as it were automatically his mood underwent a change, violent and complete. "I'll teach the old lady to drop notes all over the place," he said to himself. "I'll just teach her." And he pictured his triumph as a wise male when, during the course of the feast, his great-aunt should stumble on her loss and yield to senile feminine agitation, and he should remark superiorly, with elaborate calm, "Here is your precious money, auntie. A good thing it was I, and not burglars, who discovered it. Let this be a lesson to you. Where was it? It was on the landing carpet, if you please. That's where it was." And the nice old creature's pathetic relief. As he went jauntily downstairs, there remained nothing of his mood of intoxication except a still thumping heart. End of chapter 2.